purpose. I don't know.
Is Brian coming tonight? I just want to know if I can use his space or not. He's not coming. Okay. All right, great, good. Spread out.
The whatever proposal in here for the court. I just got to find the right pages. Okay.
Let your batteries go.
Okay. All right. Thank you, my dear. I didn't even get home. I mean, I guess that was my
same iPad, just different glasses. I didn't know they could do that.
Oh, wow. Really interesting.
Hey, there you go.
Oh, all right. Let me see. Do I have this one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Really?
All right, I'll start there just to kind of get myself back acquainted because
he'll love you.
It starts to spin.
He are all of my family. My wife Chris's family is in the area. So we'll go to my mom and dad's on Christmas Eve.
It doesn't matter to me.
On Christmas morning at our place.
Oh, okay.
And Chris's family, for whatever weird reason, is always celebrating Christmas on the night of the 25th.
The parties, yeah.
Just go from all, yeah. So everybody,
how
everybody gets to go everywhere.
To
no, that'd be great.
And they only, they're in black.
No, I don't know. It was one of the guys in our IT department took it over.
Okay, good. Let's see.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. My brother-in-law's from Honduras.
Ooh, in fact, I just put it in here, so I wouldn't forget it.
There you go.
And I volunteered to roast the pork.
That's great. Yes.
He's doing everything except for the roast pork.
Me too.
Well, yeah, I should do it that way. I'm not going to get that fancy.
Yeah.
That'll be kind of fun.
Well,
I think we'll
do the consent and then go for that. Yeah,
I'm not going to even do.
They have tamales.
Oh,
that's a popular
thing.
Yeah, because we've got teachers.
And for Easter, the popular thing is iguana, but I'm not doing that.
Sean, just a moment. Leanne.
Right. Right, right. Yeah.
Use your gavel.
Thanks. Wait till Leanne sits down.
Oh, now I got kicked off the internet again.
Okay, it's being 6:05. We'll get this meeting started. Thank you, everybody, for your indulgence for this. And thank you again, Sean. So we'll get started. Today we are missing Brian Horning. He did indicate to me he would not be able to be here. We have Paul Kenny, Ann Bauer, Ellen Lindgren, Terry Metzger, myself, Bob Green, Diane Horning, Superintendent Johnson, my apologies, Annette Ashley, Leanne Hallquist, as well as Assistant Superintendent George Mavrolis and Tom Wilbur. With that, we'll get the meeting started. Looking for approval of minutes.
I'll move approval.
I'll second.
Both regular and closed, my apologies. Okay, amendment, okay. Any questions, concerns? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Communications, citizen comments. I have nobody here requesting to speak to the board in terms of signed paperwork, but certainly this is a time when you can address the board on any issues. If anybody would like to step forward at this time and speak, you're certainly welcome to. Okay. Board communications. Yes.
I had the privilege of attending the fourth grade trip to the Capitol, and Representative Hesselbein took time out of her day to come and speak to the fourth graders, which was a very great experience. The kids were all very well behaved, and it was a fantastic field trip. And also, I attended the winter tea at Sunset Ridge, which I'm sure we've all been to the winter tea, and it's, you know, such a beautiful event. Our teacher really goes above and beyond. Mrs. Sage did a great job putting together the art show. The artwork was hot glued onto the gym wall, so taking the artwork down was a little bit of a challenge, and I was there for
Tom's like,
covers ears, please.
I was there for a pretty long time with that putty knife trying to take down.
Oh my gosh.
But it was a very nice event.
Well, that was just someone being creative.
Not the way, but not so easy.
If it was a dot in each corner, we would have been good.
I only have one thing.
Yes.
My daughter suffered a concussion last week, and she's had to go in and out of school all week at Cromery, and they have been so good to her. And just Cheryl Henry was just so wonderful with telling her to come there. We signed her in today at 11 o'clock, and the lady at the desk said, now, Annika, you know the drill. If you feel bad, you go see Mrs. Henry. So they really do seem to be, I know they're dealing with a lot more students, but it seems like, I know Cheryl's probably totally overworked over there, but she did take time out of it, and all the teachers have been so good about it. So I was very happy that, I didn't expect anything less, but I was very pleasantly surprised by all the teachers in the sixth grade and the support teachers, her band teacher, everybody. She's playing in the concert tonight, but she's not really playing, but we're going. And so Darlene got her in and got her figured out what she needs to do and whatever, and told her she only has to play as much as she plays a trombone, so it's a little much with, but she's going because she wants to be part of the group, and Darlene's been very open to that and helped her with it. So I just want to thank everybody from there, so thank you.
I wanted to say, I don't know if you're all aware, as a band parent, I am very aware, but our Middleton High School band will be marching on New Year's Day in the London New Year's Day Parade. Yesterday, they gave the parents a preview. We got to see the concert. They've been practicing on Sunday afternoons for 3 hours for many weeks. I would say probably 7 weeks or so to get to the point. And they did it that way because there are students that aren't going. And in order to make everyone feel comfortable with the fact that some are going and some aren't, all of their rehearsals have been done on Sunday. The highlight of the performance was, I don't know if, again, you may not be aware, but they have brand new band uniforms, which will be unveiled. They were unveiled yesterday for us, but they will be worn for the first time in London. So it was very exciting. They came in and, you know, circled the whole entire pack and did what they will be doing in the parade when they're marching before 500,000 people. And being
and
broadcast
millions online and
22
broadcast,
million
yeah.
because it's being wow. broadcast on the BBC all across Europe. It is the biggest thing in Europe on New Year's Day. So wow. Just That's sharing funny. My pride as a band parent and, you know, just knowing that our, and there's 205 students going between the band, the orchestra, and the choir.
Wow.
And
the
they took a bigger group this year to do Both different things yeah, and a wider variety than just marching. So it's a wonderful opportunity, and just great to know that the students in Middleton are going to be representing us in London. So,
great.
Just wanted to share that.
But are you marching?
Are you marching?
Steph Mueller's marching.
I guess I wanted to echo as well. Both my children participated in the London trip, and not only did they learn a lot about being with their friends, but also being in a foreign country, but also the music department did a fantastic job of supervising and making sure that there was an educational experience as well as that. So, again, my hat's off to the music department because both my children have nothing but great memories from that. Sure. Oh. Nope. Okay. I guess at that point, we have no more correspondence or communications. Superintendent's report.
All right. Three quick.
I'm sorry, Don. Before we go, we do have, for the people in the audience as well, we started this board meeting early because of the fact that we do have several board members which will have to leave early due to other obligations. Yeah.
And
so, there will be a different feel to this meeting than there normally is because of that fact. And there are certain issues here that we want to make sure that all board members are speaking on. So we, even though we may still have a quorum, we may not continue with all issues on here, and we may bring them back to another board meeting depending on how it goes. So I want everybody to understand how that's going and why that's happening before we get to them. I'm sorry, Don.
All right, just three items quickly. One, just a reminder, we are in the last week before winter break, right? So that's kind of coming up soon, and everybody's probably ready for a break. The week of winter break, Friday the 26th, the offices will be closed, even though DAC staff may be working. We have so many people that are out. There will be a number of people working, but we're not going to have the office itself open to the public. Just wanted to make sure that you're aware of that. A couple of other things. Tomorrow, we'll be meeting with key community communicators from the community at Middleton High School. I think we have 25 different individuals that are coming forward to talk about district issues, similarly to our conversation with the board. Candidates, budgets, priorities for the district, concerns, thoughts, challenges, that sort of a thing, to sort of open up that conversation with key community leaders, many of them from the schools, but not all of them from school organizations. So that'll be occurring tomorrow morning. And then just another piece on the bell time schedule review that we're doing with specifically with the high school, but it certainly may impact others as well. We're really looking at tweaking the schedule a little bit. If we can sort of ratchet back the end time of the day by 10 or 15 minutes without really changing the nature of the schedule itself, and maybe moving the start time, you know, a little bit later by 5 minutes or so, we may be able to do that and keep all of our DPI minutes there. So again, we're not looking at wholesale changes, but maybe some, I'd call it refinements to our schedule.
15 minutes would be so key for
yeah,
the
but it would
day.
Be important. So if we can start making some adjustments there, I think we have some good ideas. The faculty's been involved in that, and we've held our second meeting, with our third meeting being, I believe, this week as well, on Wednesday, I think. So we'll kind of keep you updated on that, but I think there's some promising ideas. And the collaboration has been really good. Steve Plank and the administrators at the high school have worked really hard with that staff. And we have some good stuff coming forward. So we'll keep you apprised of that in the new year. And that's it. Keep it short.
Great. Thank you very much. Then we're going to move forward to consent agenda. First of all, we'll start with 8A1, approval of bills payable. 8A2, approval of treasurer's report. To be 3, approval of staff appointments, plus the addendum that's in your packet. As well, I'd like to add some additional items to consent with the approval of the board. If anybody would like it pulled, then we certainly won't put it on consent. Approval of continuation of VER benefits for 2015-2016. Are there any concerns? Or can we put that on consent?
Okay. We're approving that without knowing our budget? Just asking. Go ahead.
At this particular time, that was already in the budget. Is that correct, Tom? We were continuing the benefits for next year?
Well, we haven't developed the budget yet, but it's right. Certainly something we would recognize.
Okay, all right.
The budget development process, yes.
But if you'd like, we can certainly pull that, because it's a certainly important question. And a vote on WSCB, a resolution for state school board convention. Are there any concerns of that, or can we add that to consent as well? Or Ellen, would you like to discuss that during?
No, just nobody got in touch with me. If you do have concerns about particular resolutions, please do get in touch with me. There's a few that are a little dicey, but.
Do we need a roll call on the line of credit?
Yeah, please feel free to get in touch with me.
Is the line of credit
it doesn't say.
Yeah,
it does require a roll call.
Okay. All right, it doesn't say on here. Okay.
All right, so at that point in time, those are the items for a consent agenda that I would be looking for a motion on.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any questions?
Did you pull the
VER?
The borrowing and the VER?
No,
borrowing is not.
Borrowing was not in, but VER is in.
Okay. This is VER.
Oh, I okay. Just need to.
Yeah, that one needs we need a roll call vote for
okay.
That.
Yes, 9A is not in there, yeah.
Yeah, because yes.
Mm-hmm. So A and C are still out.
Yep.
Okay.
All those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Thank you very much for that. Do appreciate it. So on that particular point, let me finish going through here. I guess we'll go to Tom. Approval of line of credit 9A.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Any questions, concerns? Okay, roll call.
Aye.
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 Okay.
Sorry, Tom.
Thank you. Oh, that's just fine.
That's how he likes it.
Mm-hmm. All right, now we get to move into the meat and potatoes. So Don?
So we have these two things.
Approval of 2015-2016 teacher's handbook revisions, and you have kind of a layout on this, so we can make sure that if we run out of time, that we can still continue with this.
This would just maybe be a suggestion. My reading of this, and I think this has been presented to the board before, is that most of the language in the handbook has been agreed to by the entire committee, which I think everybody should celebrate. It's kind of a Happy New Year moment for that. We do have five items that should be probably just reviewed and or discussed at different levels. The one that probably would take the most time is revolving around transfer language, and that's sort of two components within one. So it's got two different elements, the voluntary and the involuntary. I would suggest that we do that last. So if, for whatever reason, we run out of time, we could certainly sort of circle back to that and do it in January if need be. Hopefully there's enough time tonight, but if not, we'd at least not be rushing through anything that the board hadn't fully considered. So that being the last item I would suggest, the other items would be breach of contract. We had some new language for that with some new numbers. That would be one. The second would be keeping awareness phase documentation in a teacher's file beyond 4 years, either permanently, and I think the suggestion of the teachers, or at least some teachers, is eliminating that after 4 years or pulling that after 4 years. One that I want to make the board aware of that there was agreement on, but it has budget implications, is the change in the overload language, especially at the secondary level. Currently, we pay a 0.14 for an additional class, when an additional class generally is a 0.2 or 20%. So the recommendation of the committee was to move the overload language, which predominantly deals with secondary level because of the structure of their day, from a 0.14 to a 0.2 because it's an additional class and we would count that equally. The impact of that budgetarily is about $22,000. It could be as low as 20 or maybe as high as 24, given the year and how many overloads we have. But that would be the recommendation, I think, of the full committee to go to that arrangement. We can certainly ask Tabitha any questions you might have there. So that's not a disagreement item, but it is something that the board should be aware of in the handbook. And then the last item was mentioned by the board the last time around, and that was that salary-related items may be recommended and discussed in the compensation committee, and those would have to be approved by the Board of Education, but those may not circle back to the handbook committee because we're doing that in the context of compensation. And I think one of the statements that the board made is that we won't change anything in the handbook unless the committee is reconvened. But in this case, we have another committee with at least two members from the previous one, and you indicated an interest in stating very overtly that if something changed in the area of compensation due to that process, that you didn't want to feel that you had not lived up to your commitment. So you wanted to make that kind of a statement. If that's something that you want to continue to do, I just wanted to remind you of that.
And maybe if with the board's indulgence, we can go in reverse order. I think that one would be the easiest just to kind of get through.
Sure.
And again, I had brought this up because I think it's very important that we be very upfront. We had said in our language that we were not going to make any changes in the handbook without running through the handbook committee, but that language was in the handbook. We are running through the compensation committee. So we are still running it through a committee of the employees, but just so everybody's up front, not saying, well, wait a minute, you told me one thing and you're doing another.
Yeah.
I'd like us just to make a statement and Don can reiterate back to the handbook committee after the fact that we are doing this still in an open manner, but we're not running that particular part of the compensation through the handbook committee.
Yeah, and compensation committee might look at, they might say, well, what about additives? We have this piece that we'd really like to take a look at. We don't really have anything in mind, but we know that they're looking at the whole picture of salaries, so we felt that it would be a little bit, I think it, actually the board brought this up, that it would be difficult to sort of go through this whole process in compensation and then reopen a handbook committee and reevaluate the whole thing after we did a committee process. So that was the caveat that I think this board mentioned a couple of weeks ago.
So I'm not certain that we need a motion on it, but at least an understanding. So either the board can speak to this issue or we can make a motion and speak to it. But I'd just like to make sure before we leave it, it's very clear what our intention is. Still to work inside the process that we have, but in this case it's not directed through the handbook, it's directed through the compensation committee, even though that language originally started in the handbook.
No objections.
No objections. I think it makes sense.
Okay.
No objections. Makes
Okay, then Don, you can at least...
We can just let the minutes reflect that, so I think that that would be documentation enough that we're in a good position.
And then you can, the next time the handbook meets, you know, the same thing, express that as well.
Well, going, using your cue, we could talk about overload language and whether or not that, there's some concern about that. That would have to be built into the budget. As Tom mentioned, it's not in there right now. The total amount is $22,000. That's the estimate for this year. We would recommend if that were passed, that that would be applied this year. So it would be an expense this year. The board could say, oh, no, we don't want to do that this year, but we think it is viable to do that this year and would recommend that.
Just ask a process question. Do you want motions on these individual items?
I think it'd be easier to do motions on each of these because then if somebody had a disagreement on one, they could simply express that difference.
So do we, go ahead. You can do it. I'll second you.
Whatever it is. Either way.
Either one of us is going to have to second the other one.
Move that the, it's not called an additive, it's called an
overload.
Overload.
Be retroactive to this year and continue into the future at 0.2 rather than 0.14.
Correct.
Second.
Any further questions or concerns? All those in favor say aye. I'm sorry. My apologies.
Tom, do you feel that that's a good direction for us to head budgetary rationale?
Well, it's a cost-effective way without having to hire additional staff, so it does provide us some flexibility. And I think gives us some incentives for existing staff to step into some of those roles with a little bit of extra funding. So for substantially more than that, I think I'd raise a concern, but $22,000, $23,000, $24,000 is probably reasonable.
One benefit we have is if we do hire, for example, five overloads at a 0.2, that's a 1.0, but we don't end up really paying any more
benefits,
health insurance benefits and others. So there is some financial benefit to the district, but we've already realized that in many cases otherwise. But so this would be an extra expense, but we are incurring some savings. We generally don't try to do this. It's when we have an extra class and it's hard to hire a 0.2 social studies or math teacher. Yeah. So we'll
add
on class.
Example this year, how many do we have that are in an overload situation?
Ballpark.
Thank you.
Go back and look at the list, but it's not overly many.
Okay.
Okay. Any further questions? Yes.
I think another benefit, not just the savings on the benefits, but also you've got a teacher who's in the system, who's had the training, who has the background in the curriculum, so they're not jumping into something cold, which I think is a real advantage for the students.
Okay. Yeah. Any further?
Okay.
Anybody else? Okay. Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. We're knocking off the easy one.
I kind of like going from the bottom up. It's a nice thing, yeah. The third item, actually, it is number three, whether you go up or down, is the awareness phase. And this was a conversation, and this is where I think that there may be some teachers that want to speak to this from the committee. The basic question was, if a teacher goes on an awareness phase, and just to kind of remind everybody, if there's a concern about teaching a teacher's performance, the first stage is going through an awareness stage where the teacher is, in a more formal way, told we have a concern, this is the concern, we're going to take basically 60 to 90 days to determine if we can kind of correct this without a regular or full plan for improvement. The suggestion that was made by at least a couple of teachers was that after 4 years of an awareness stage, and phase, that be removed from the teacher's employment file and that become a completely clean file and that there would be no documentation of that. Administratively, our recommendation is that we would keep that in the file, and the reason for keeping that in the file is probably has three different rationales. One of them is that we have had at least five or six different situations since I've been here where files have been expunged, and then we've had another question later on, and then coming back to it, there's nothing in the file, so there's nothing that was really evidentiary for the district to kind of go back to, so technically there was no record of anything, and we felt that that's important, is just to keep that record. Secondly, the file is a private file. Nobody has access to it except for the employee, the supervisor, and essentially employee services, which would be Tabitha Gundrum or possibly me as superintendent. Basically, there's a very limited access. The file does not is not open to the public. It doesn't go to another district if they apply someplace else, so it is a private file. The third part of our rationale, and I'll certainly let the teachers speak to their piece as well, was that we felt that actually demonstrating that you've been in an awareness phase and you've corrected the action and moved forward is actually a positive thing. And it could document the fact that, yes, there was a concern, but it was addressed, it was dealt with, and you've kind of moved on. So that was kind of our perspective on that. But rather than speaking for any of the teachers, I certainly don't want to do that. I'd be open to having them sort of certainly speak as well.
Can I ask a question
sure.
first? In private industry, you have an evaluation meeting and everyone gets evaluated and they sit there with your file and go, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Does that happen in our teacher effectiveness training? Would you go back to everybody's file and go, oh, well, 4 years ago they had this and that should impact their evaluation today?
No, we would not.
Okay. So that's the difference. As my husband said, you know, if you had a bad supervisor at one point and you got written up or whatever 4 or 5 years ago, he goes, you shouldn't have that bear on you 5 years later when you're working a totally different job somewhere else in this big, huge company. But they, because they do bring that file in, put your name up there and go, well, you know, 5 years ago, so-and-so did this. You don't use this as a way for your teacher effectiveness.
No.
Okay.
The only exception to that I'll mention to you is that if a principal were to have a concern about a teacher, they would probably first say, wow, I'm kind of worried about this. I wonder if there's any record of this that where this has occurred anywhere else. They may go to a file in that case to try to see, has this occurred before? Is there anything there? Our principals sometimes have been here 2, 3, actually some just their first year, and they may say, gee, this is a concern. Has it ever been out there before? And we may have numerous administrators, so there's no record of kind of what they've done. They'd certainly look at an evaluation if they needed to.
But if this were in here,
no.
They're not going to go back and use it year after year to evaluate this person against his or her peers.
No. Okay. Before we go much further, we're moving into a new process here where we have, in theory, and the board has talked about where we're going to have two proposals here. So I guess at this point, with the board's permission, the handbook committee has discussed this issue and they have brought forward to us and given us student writing some of their alternative proposals. Administration has a proposal. Right now, we do have it in order that the teachers would present verbal their position, and then after that, administration would. And I would like to give all the board members a chance to ask those questions, no different than where we're at now, if you're okay with that. So as the handbook committee, have somebody to speak to their proposal?
Myself.
Please come on up, Jill. Well, if you could introduce yourself, I'm sure everybody here knows you.
Jill Allen Pauls, early childhood special education teacher and MEA vice president in the Middleton-Cross Plains Area School District.
And you have been selected by the handbook committee to represent this?
Yes.
Thank you.
I have. this was an issue that we kind of went round and round about, and it wasn't, I wouldn't say it was in total disagreement, but I think it's more of a perspective piece. I do understand that it is important that we have that information available if there's going to continue to be concern with a staff member. But I think we can, as it was stated, that information is always available. It might not be in the person's personnel file, but there's another separate file where they used to go, because this did used to be part of our contract language. And what it comes down to is, yes, if you resolve that issue and that is in your file, that feels very powerful and showing improvement. But also, I think for what we heard back from staff wasn't necessarily if this is going to be a continuation. It was more, I made a mistake. It's something I corrected. I have shown that it's not an issue. There has not been any follow-up. So let's say I'm here 15, 16 years later. There it is, still in my file. And it may not reflect my evaluation or my performance scores or ratings in that way, but it does affect me knowing it's in there, and I worked really, really hard to fix it. I like the opportunity for it to be removed. If there's going to continue to be concerns with the teacher's performance, there certainly are things in place that we can also have that we are effectively using to make sure that it's not a continuous concern. And I would think that if it is, that would be addressed more frequently.
So, you know, if you could explain verbally what it is that you're looking for that's different from what administration is proposing.
Well, we're looking to have that piece removed after 4 years if the teacher has shown that they have made the changes, that they have improved whatever area it is that they needed to improve, if they're on an awareness phase, and if there have been no other further concerns. And I think you could look at probably using the educator effectiveness, and if they're at proficient or above, and there's not additional concerns, then it's not looking like this is going to be something we need to keep track of in your file because we think there's going to be more concerns.
Hello. I guess I was a little surprised to see this in the packet this mm-hmm. evening. Having been at that meeting, the vote was 11-2
right.
to take these items, to leave these items in mm-hmm. the file indefinitely. I don't know. I came away from that meeting thinking that this was now resolved.
Right.
And I sit here and I do want the board to know that there was a minority mm-hmm. opinion to keep it, to take
right.
it out of the file.
Right. And originally, we weren't going to include it, but we did hear back that there was some confusion with the vote. Some people thought, and I know you tried to make it very clear, but it was mm-hmm. the end of the night. We were all kind of punchy. Some people felt that they were voting to remove it from the handbook, not remove it from the file. So there was a little confusion there. So we thought we'd bring it back, present it, and if we really felt strongly that, no, this is something that we don't want as a part of our handbook, then that's what we're going to have to go with. But at the very least, we wanted to be sure we presented it. So all sides were heard and understood.
Okay, thanks.
Any questions? No.
I just had a clarification question, kind of to Leanne's question earlier. So from building to building, it would follow you, your administrator that you have currently might not have been the administrator that you had at the time of the placing of the...
Right.
Okay.
This would be in your district file.
And can I ask another question? Joellen had mentioned that previously these were in a different folder.
Well, this piece is a sort of, there's a formal file that's in personnel. There are certainly files that principals keep in basically at their building that is more of a, I'd call it sort of maybe a full documentation file that may have more background and more process information. So I'd say that the summative information would be in their personnel file at the district level, and the file at the school level would be more background and process based. The difficulty with that is that I'm not sure that that file structure is really designed to be permanent nor to be tracked. So if you go principal to principal, that file may not necessarily kind of be a permanent file. And I know we can sort of do like a formal file and then kind of like a semi-formal file. But in my view, the only real permanent file is the permanent official file mm-hmm. that we have. I know you keep some background information, but that's where it gets a little murky. You start doing, is it a valid piece of information if it's not part of the formal file? And I think that that's a component to this one. But Tabitha, do you want to speak to that a little bit, just briefly?
I would only mention two things. One is I have an investigation file for anything that involves a more involved process. Awareness phase is one of those where I keep kind of a notes file because I'm at the meeting and taking notes at all of those meetings usually. So there, I do keep a separate file with all the detail pieces, but only the final evals are the ones that go into the personnel file. And then the second piece, and this is what we spoke to handbook, was there have been a number of situations where through a process with an attorney, the attorney's talking back and forth, there was a decision to remove something from a person's file. In those cases where that has happened, it's been removed from the personnel file but moved into another file in my office with that person's name separate and apart from the personnel file so that the record wasn't lost, because the attorneys that we work with have said it's really not a great idea to remove historical pieces like that, but occasionally there are reasons why they did agree to that in certain circumstances. A few of those are the ones that Don mentioned that we've sort of gotten bit on later, where things were removed and I wasn't even aware that that was agreed to. We've had a few of those because that was done outside of my purview. So
this is in the personnel file that lives here at the DAC. It wouldn't necessarily be floating around following a teacher from building to building.
No. Correct. You are correct. It would be in the personnel file in my office, my department office. And basically the way that it would work is if another situation came up, let's say it's 6 years down the road, and a principal calls me and says, you know, is there any record of anything regarding XYZ that they just were involved with, then I would pull the file. I would go through the file and say, nope, I don't see anything, or you know what, yes, it was referenced during this time, they improved, it's documented clearly that they came out of that process, that's where we leave it. So.
Yeah, Paul, then Diane.
Okay.
Under this is my newbie status, coming back to haunt me again. Under the collective bargaining agreement, was there a provision, because I know other collective bargaining agreements have provisions that say, if employee X is disciplined and that employee goes 3 years without having any other discipline, this incident of discipline will be removed from the file. Was there stuff like that in the collective bargaining
agreement? It was not part of the collective bargaining agreement, but my understanding from prior to me coming is that that was a fairly typical request/demand to settle items.
Okay.
And I think that presented problems for me personally when a subsequent issue came up, and in one case a previous superintendent had made an agreement that had not been forwarded to employee services, and the files were not accurate, and so we were moving forward on the basis that the permanent file was correct. When there was an agreement previously to withdraw something from the file, there was a subsequent problem with that individual, and so we ended up having to retract a longer track record of concern and expunge that sort of circumstance from a previous situation. And I don't think it was a good practice, in my opinion.
Based on what Tabitha said, you know, that separate file that got pulled and was put in file number 2, if a principal called you and asked if there was anything in that personnel file, and there wasn't anything in the major file, would you then have gone to look at the other files?
I always do as a matter of practice.
So then really it might as well be in the file.
Exactly.
Because it's around.
Exactly.
And if you never have an issue again, it doesn't matter.
Right? Well, exactly. You know, in my view, if a teacher has a problem and rectifies the problem, I think the very biggest and most powerful statement in their favor is that they've fixed it and haven't had any problems since. If, you know, teachers kind of know when somebody's on a plan of improvement, and if 5 years down the road the teacher wants to transfer to another building and people are like, well, you know, I heard they had a problem, how did that go, you know? And if there's no way to go back and say, this person's great now, I think it can work against a teacher not to have that in the file, if they've done their job.
Yeah. I've never worked in any industry where I saw personnel files being amended after a certain time. So I've got concerns with us going back and amending files. I think they should keep it in there, you keep track of it. There shouldn't be any issues if the issues don't repeat.
One more question for Joellen. Joellen, is the value to your perception anyway, mm-hmm. of the value to the mm-hmm. teachers in this, one of personal morale? It's the fact that the teacher can reflect on the fact that I screwed up at this time, but I've worked through it and it's not in my file anymore. I know it's not going to follow me around and haunt me. Is that chiefly the value in it?
And I do think that's a really good way, Paul, to capture it, because it's difficult, because obviously there's a different perspective when you're the one who has to make sure that things are being followed the way they need to be, things are getting done the way they need to be, and things aren't, like you said, coming back to bite you. But unfortunately, I mean, that's not really where staff was coming from with their concern. It was more that morale thing, which... You know, I guess that's a hard thing to kind of argue for, because everything I'm hearing here is, well, I haven't heard of this practice, and we don't think it's a good practice. It probably wouldn't be a good idea to remove anything from anyone's personnel file. But what it absolutely does come down to, and we did discuss this at the committee, and we had somewhat of a, you know, I think a pretty open discussion, it does come down to morale. And I could say, I can speak for myself personally, I don't think I have anything in there, I'm not aware that I do, but if I did,
that would
be because you're on the awareness phase. The awareness phase.
Hand delivered.
But it is that kind of, I just, you don't want that mark there. You know, I worked really hard, I fixed it, I did what I needed to do, and yes, I know that I can write something, and there can be something written in there that I did it, but it's always going to be there that, yeah, but she did. Yeah, but look what happened. Yeah, but, well, she fixed it. How do we know that it's not going to happen again? Or she's going to be the kind of teacher we need her to be for our building or our team. And that is a hard thing to argue, because it does come down to it's how you feel personally. I know I brought up, you know, getting a speeding ticket or getting that A on a graduate course. I don't need to get the A. It's not going to change how much I make. It's not going to make me a better teacher, but I want that A on my transcript. It's kind of that same kind of feeling that you want to see it there. It makes a big difference to you personally and for your morale as a teacher. Thank you. That was a little more concise than I was able to say.
Sorry, I just want to make sure I understood.
And I guess I want to do a quick follow-up, and I want to make sure I understand a couple of things. We are actually talking about the existence of two different mm-hmm. files, one of which is one is it's going to be in the principal's report, where he keeps track of the more day-to-day things, so one which would be a part of this. And then we have the second file, which is kept in HR, which I think legally we have to have right. something there. So we're not talking about the at all, and you're not talking about, and I'll make sure I'm clear on this, are you talking about the HR file? Because we really, I'm not certain we can change that,
no.
the one that Tabitha maintains. You are talking about the principal's file.
No, the personnel file.
Personnel file.
I'm sorry, yes.
That's the HR file.
Yeah. Again, because I'm going to stop right here and then I'm going to ask Tabitha a question. What are the legal ramifications of that? Are we even able to do that? Because I know, Terry, you kind of mentioned that point. Once something's put into a file, mm-hmm. are we in a liable situation?
So we've had agreements in the past, like I mentioned, with attorneys when we work through certain instances where we have removed documentation from files. It is not a recommended practice, but it's not necessarily prohibited either. Best practice would be that you keep everything in the file to document anything that's been inserted. If it's important enough to document to the file, it's an important enough piece to be a part of the permanent record. And I do think that, that really is what it boils down to. So it's not illegal or prohibited from removing. It's just a matter of, is that a good practice
not
overall?
Best practice.
And that's really what this comes down to.
But then if, I'm going to flip the other side, if the principal has access to that file, but on their day-to-day decision-making, generally they need a reason to ask for that file, because that's not something that's kept in their desk to say, because we do have a fairly large turnover in our principals, unless their day-to-day file is kept in there. That's something that would be kept there and they would need to ask you for.
They would, yeah. If they need something out of the main file in my office, they would have to go through me and get my approval. My staff don't just even hand that over. They always check with me before releasing anything. I do think pretty much anything that's been inserted in my file at the district office, usually there's a duplicate copy that the principal has in their file. But you're right, as there's turnover or as a person transfers to another building, that file may or may not go in full or in part. So that's partly why my main file, the official one, is the one that's so important to have everything in it.
And the last question, all employees have a right to inspect their file and also have a right to put a note in that file if indeed that there is something that they disagree with.
Absolutely, and that is a legal requirement that they be able to do that.
Okay. After we've asked our questions, do you have any further follow-up you'd like to make? Then otherwise I'll have Don make your presentation.
I don't have...
I'll just stay there, John, and we'll have you back again.
I don't know that there's a lot more outside of the fact that we've talked a little bit about different file structures, and you should probably know that if... there are, it's a little bit more complex because there are lots of different situations. If someone's on a substantial plan for improvement, a plan for improvement could be a file on its own, and that wouldn't be part of the summative file. So if I was on a plan for improvement for 6 months, and there's all the documentation that could be a three-ring binder, that might not be in the summative file, that might be in the support file. So that's one other sort of element of this. The principal may have sort of a day-to-day file that they keep on their teachers, and it may not necessarily even be negative. It may be more about just information that they're trying to collect for, could be even positive notes from teachers. I mean, it's not like files are necessarily bad. So there's kind of that working file that a principal has. Then there may be documentation to support, the personnel file that's formal that Tabitha's referring to, and then the final sort of summative file, which is kind of like final evaluations and other final documentation, the summative pieces. So, and it's that third level of files with the principal that a principal has that are probably less just. All the data isn't always relevant. A principal might say, I'm leaving, and I look at this file that I've got for Don Johnson, and it's kind of like this thick, and there's most of it's just not relevant. Let's just actually shred that, get rid of it, and then maybe my working file when I leave as a principal would go to the next principal. But I would kind of be careful about, I had two parents that maybe I didn't have full confidence in, and they had complaints. I have to keep that complaint in there so that I can document what they charged and how I responded. So that would be maybe in my file, but it wouldn't necessarily be something that I felt was maybe legitimate, but I need to make sure that if I needed to refer to it, mm-hmm. I'd had it. I mean, I do that when I receive a complaint, and you probably do as well. It may or may not be legitimate, but I keep it whether it is or not so that I can remember how I dealt with it. So the file that is a working file of a principal has all sorts of different things that would help him sort of recall what happened 6 months ago, 2 years ago, 5 years ago, so that they can just kind of keep track of things. So hopefully that helps. I mean, I think, we're almost speaking like we have hundreds of these. So these are right. Very limited. I mean, I think right now, plan for improvement, two teachers right now? Maybe three?
I don't even know if I have any on improvement. I know.
Excuse me, plan for awareness.
Two or three.
None for improvement now. And two or three for awareness?
Yeah.
Out of 556.
Okay.
And one of the reasons that we actually have three, I think, is that we didn't really have a system to do this for, until the last couple, 2 or 3 years.
Further questions here? So we have, right now, in terms of board, I'm just going to phrase it up just slightly, and I don't want to stay away from guiding the conversation too much. We have three options, or four options, I should say. First option is we accept one or the teacher's proposal. The second would be administration's proposal. Third would be a hybrid, where we make changes and questions for amendments. And fourth would be just to reject everything and kick it back. So at this particular point, I guess I would be looking for a motion, some type of an indication which way the board would like to go.
I'd make a motion to accept administration's proposal.
Second.
Okay. Any further questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay. Move forward to the next item.
The next item is breach of contract. And I'll probably turn this over pretty quickly to Joellen because really what we had inserted was some documentation on amounts depending on when somebody breached the contract. So if you leave your position after the school year starts, that's certainly a higher penalty than if you left in, like, on June 30th or something. So it's kind of a graduated system. I think that's part of the packet. The other piece, I think, was the language that Joellen spoke to. And maybe what I'll do is just let her talk about that because there were, I think this was part of the packet on, I think it was on page, I'm not sure what page it was, but it was
42.
Section 8.505. So maybe I can just let
42 of 108 on our packet.
42?
Oh, wait, here it is. Some numbers in there.
It's their chart.
Oh, it's their chart. And it's also on page 39, right? Verified circumstances beyond their control. There is that language. And then maybe
right.
There's something on page 42. I don't know. Maybe it's just easier to...
Yeah. So basically it wasn't... I don't think we want anything changed with the amount and understand that we have not been at the same level as other districts, surrounding districts, and that may or may not have hurt us.
But we were looking for maybe a provision that would allow a teacher who has to resign due to a verified medical illness injury, but in addition to a verified circumstance beyond their control, such as if a spouse or significant other would get a job out of state or that would take them away from this position. If that could be verified, that would be another reason that maybe the superintendent would consider waiving the fee.
And one thing speaking to that, that I thought of is that we could certainly look at, let's just say, under the specific language, it said it wasn't a medical illness or an injury, that we could certainly look at either an appeal to superintendent or resolution of differences language. Because I think that the problem probably with verified circumstances beyond their control is there could probably be a pretty wide range of what that could be to contend that. So I wouldn't, for example, necessarily feel that in every case we would impose a breach of contract.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because I think some circumstances we actually have not, when there has been a spouse transfer. But there have been other circumstances where some people would say, well, one thing that was outside of my control is that I was offered a job and it was outside of my control when that job was offered to me. I'm not trying to make fun of that because I think people would say that. I mean, I think it would be hard to define that. And I'm not trying to make light of it, but, you know, I think we've tried to be understanding, though, there was a high school teacher whose spouse got a job in Oshkosh, and it was just after the school year started. And I think we felt, you know what, we understand that they're a newlywed couple. They didn't really have all this figured out, and I think we waived it. So I don't think we're unwilling to do that.
Okay.
But I don't know that we could just do a blanket, because that would be open-ended for everything. So that was kind of where we were thinking.
Well, I thought of maybe a compromise thing to tack on to the bottom of the administration principle. Any teacher may also seek waiver of this provision for a breach that occurs for circumstances beyond his or her control.
They may seek.
That's what
they just may seek appeal to the superintendent.
Seek a waiver, sure.
Right.
And I think that's kind of what I was thinking about when I read through this documentation.
Like,
I don't know that we would guarantee it, because I think the way it was stated in some of that language, but
documents which already do, right?
Yeah.
Right.
I think something to that effect would make teachers feel a little better about the increase, because there certainly are things that do come up. I don't think people make the decision to leave the district mid-year, beginning of the year, end of the year, lightly.
No,
it's not an easy thing to do, because, A, if you're the one leaving, you know you're putting your families, your parents, your staff, your colleagues, administration in a bind. So if I or someone else am choosing to leave, it's not because I just decided on a whim, hey, I think there's a job that I might like better over here. I'm going to decide to apply for it now to make my life more difficult and pay the $1,500 and see you later. I think it was more directed towards those circumstances that do happen. And more often than I think maybe we are aware, you don't have any control where your spouse is going to get a job or your significant other may get a job, or maybe you have a spouse who has a job where they get transferred and they have no control over when or how or how frequently that's going to happen. So I guess in those circumstances, I think it would make staff feel better about that whole change, because it is a big change. It's a huge amount. And if you have to go, you have to go. Mm-hmm. You're going to pay the amount.
Okay. And I know, my apologies, that we're going to lose some board members.
645.
Real quick here.
Are you okay?
Okay, I'm not sure when you have to leave. Go ahead.
I move accepting administration's recommendation with the addition of Paul's phrase,
seek
waiver.
Any teacher may also seek waiver of this provision for a breach that occurs for circumstances beyond his or her control.
Perfect.
Second. You got that all down, Cheryl, right?
Second.
And who are they seeking this approval? Who are they seeking?
With superintendent. With superintendent.
Okay. Suggest from the superintendent district administration.
And, you know, again, we have done that, I think, on a couple of occasions this year already. It probably would have
been a year in Atlanta when I moved up here to meet her contract.
Okay.
I was going to ask a question. Are you comfortable with that?
As long as it's clear that it's not just cut and dry. It has to be medical. It has to be illness.
I was in a situation where a teacher decided to leave from my student's class in November this year for a better job. So it happens, unfortunately.
Oh, right. Sure.
I mean, I can understand the reason.
Do we have a motion to second?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Already.
So at this particular point, we have a motion and a second. Any further questions? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? And my apology a little bit here. A concern has been brought to me from some board members and also from administration as well. I do appreciate it. We have to be kind of careful when you make a proposal as well as that we're not negotiating. We're still back and forth making things, so we're kind of on the edge there. I think it's important that board hears and understands the teacher's concerns and that we act accordingly upon that. But I also don't want somebody interpreting our questions back and forth as a negotiation type situation. But unless the board has an objection, at this point, this is new process. I want to make sure we're all comfortable with this process as we move forward, because it does need to be done in an open manner. I just want to make sure we don't step into that type of situation. So,
new turf.
New turf. Very new turf.
New turf. We're doing our best.
Yeah. Are we leaving? We can, but at the same time, there's a very legitimate concern brought forward that we really should have the entire, as many members of the board as possible, talking about negotiating these items. I'm sorry, my apologies. Negotiating amongst the board members.
We moved this meeting earlier to discuss that one, and we haven't even gotten to that one, which was the transfer language. So that's why I came at 6, to do the transfer language, and then we did everything but that.
Well, I think it was important for you to be a part of the language that we have discussed right now.
I'm saying that if you're going to continue with the transfer language.
I move that we defer this to the next meeting.
That's where I was going with this.
I think this is something that every board member should be here to discuss. It shouldn't have a pre-discussion and then another discussion. I just don't think that's the right way to handle these issues.
That's where I was going with that, Leanne, is that we were going to table it until we brought it to the next one with the board's permission.
So we're going to vote on this last one.
We had a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay.
Who made the second?
I did. Can I just ask one thing before you guys leave? Can we move the rest of the body of the handbook and second it and approve it and pull those items so that you guys have the ability to vote on that?
Yeah, so you can basically approve the teacher's handbook with the exception of voluntary and involuntary transfer for a discussion. Hopefully, first board meeting in January.
So moved.
Second.
Okay.
I just thought at least you guys could be.
Any questions at this point? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Okay, you had a motion, and you were going to make an update when the other two were kind of got it.
Did we just do that?
So I was acknowledging.
That's the motion.
Okay, yep. So at that particular point.
January.
I want to
be the first. I think it's
January 14th. I'd like to be coming to your table.
We'd like to have you there.
We do.
Dismissed.
Thanks, Joellen.
Right here.
Same, Merry same Christmas. Time, same place.
Happy New Year. Happy holidays.
Thank you.
Thanks. This is a conference.
Not the same time.
Happy concert.
Okay, where are we at then?
So we did everything but the transfer language.
Right. So
we're back to
open enrollment, though.
You're back to open enrollment.
Because we have the handbook still.
Just have one.
It's just information.
99.9% of the
handbook. Thank you.
I'll be up north.
I'm with you.
It's concert night.
Tomorrow night. Agenda. 5:30.
5:30.
Yeah.
Actually, we got a lot done.
We did.
See you next year. Happy New Year.
So we have one item left, open enrollment discussion.
Oh, that's right, open enrollment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then George?
Our open enrollment expert.
George sure. if you look at the chart that really looks like this, that's actually the first one in your packet, you'll notice we don't have a lot of spaces for open enrollment this year. When Cheryl kind of went through the charts and then kind of showed them to me, but this is for discussion, and we can come back in January if you want to tweak or change anything.
Thank you.
Right now, if you look at first grade, that's our current small kindergarten class. We're projected enrollment of 414 next year for first grade. Assuming a class size cap for open enrollment purposes of 20 across the district, we'd have 46 available spaces. Cheryl and I sat down, and we could, not that we would probably get this many first graders, but we could absorb up to 30 first graders and spread them where we would assign them, and our class sizes would still be under 20 across the district. So it's something to think about. The other thing, if you're not comfortable with that number, we could change our class size cap for open enrollment. We could drop it to 19 or 18, which would lower that number. So that's how we have flexibility as a school district, is to determine what we feel is our class size cap for open enrollment.
That's how you handle it with DPI?
Yes.
Because there are requirements in that place.
Yes.
We'll start from the Google Cross.
One of the concerns I have, first of all, as you say, we don't have a choice on, you know, how many first graders are going to apply, but these students also age appropriately with their cohorts. And so as they go forward and students enter our district, we may or may not have as much room in that grade level that as we thought that they would. And in addition, and correct me if I'm wrong, without question or without any exceptions, we always have been accepting the siblings of the students that correct. Come into our district. So there is a really big unknown with accepting any students whatsoever on open enrollment because of the sibling issue. Now, how many students did we have new this year? It was like...
Well, the second sheets that you
I
have...
I mean, I just, you know, I know
the existing open enrollment students in our district mm-hmm. by school and by grade. So you can just kind of see. So, for example, at Elm Juan, we have a total of 10 open enrollment students currently. And then we just rolled them over for next year. Northside has 9 total. Sauk Trail has 8 total. So it gives you a ballpark.
Mm-hmm. But my point is that we are growing rapidly. You know, we aren't a district that has not seen growth. And for the last 3 years, we've had quite a bit of growth. So I'm concerned bringing more open enrollment when we are already starting to talk about some space issues in our buildings, even after we've built a middle school.
One issue we have with first grade is that it is more likely that a family having a first grader comes in and could have subsequent siblings. So it may not be the first grade that's the concern, mm-hmm. but it could be then they may have a 5-year-old brother,
a 3-year-old,
3-year-old sister,
some not born yet,
1-year-old. You know, so there's if it's the oldest in a family, it sort of opens a door to potential family. If you've got like a, it's a little bit less likely if you've got like a 12 slots for 8th grade that you're going to be able to see this cascade of children coming through. And again, it isn't. It's just the reality of the age mm-hmm. group. Especially for the oldest.
With kindergarten having a minus 17 and 4K having a minus 3.
Right.
I mean, the subsequent siblings is a big
It's a real big problem.
Yeah, we could change the class size cap of first grade to match kindergarten at 18, and then we would be at a 0 for first grade.
No.
One option.
Sure, go ahead, Ellen.
I'd be in favor of that. I think it's not just the siblings, and it's not just that they're going to grow and more people are going to be added in, but it's also when you have a bubble in another grade and you need another classroom, and if you've filled up every classroom because we added 40 kids, then you don't have as much flexibility within each building. So I think, you know, just in terms of the macro look, I think it would be better to drop it to 18 and then just say we're closed.
Okay. Yeah.
I think another budgetary consideration is, you know, in the last biennial budget, we received $150 per pupil, but in the upcoming budget, the really kind of the early indicators are that we may not even be able to count on any per pupil mm-hmm. money. So that's also taking on additional students without the additional dollars that we saw in the last time we made this decision.
And to your point there, just a quick jump in, 0.6, Tom, what is it that we get for a revenue limit on an open enrollment student?
None.
So the reality of it is
non-resident. We get the about $6,700.
Yeah, almost $7,000.
Right. So that's right around 0.60%. Somewhere around 60% is what we receive. The one issue that I have with that is that because we receive so little state aid, 10%, 11%, 12%, somewhere in that area. 12%. Let's just say as a number. The rest of that money is financed. That difference between the $6,000 and the $12,000 is financed by our tax holder, by the taxpayers or property taxpayers in our area. And the people who are moving in open enrollment are not property taxpayers. So they are actually, we are funding people who live outside of our area because we receive so little state aid. So it is a concern for myself as well. I mean, obviously there are circumstances where it's needed, but I myself would be in favor of keeping it to a minimum. I guess I'm looking for a motion at this particular. We don't need a motion to discussion.
You guys decide that.
I think you're recommending that we drop our
you guys decide.
We have to bring this back in January.
We bring that back and then you approve it.
Okay. Are there any other questions on any of the other numbers? That's what we'll bring back next
strategy.
Yeah. Okay. At this particular point, just a reminder, we do have an agenda meeting tomorrow at 5:30. And other than that, I would be looking.
A.M. or P.M.?
Yes, ma'am. You can show up to either one.
It's 2 a.m. It'll be a fast meeting.
Very much so. So I think we're finished. So, motion to go.